Hello everybody, my name is Walter and this is episode 11 of my Redstone component series. In this episode I will talk about the slime and the honey block. Those two blocks are not really Redstone components since they are not in the Redstone menu, but they are so important and useful in many Redstone contraptions that they deserve their own episode. Anyway, I will start as always with some general information about those blocks, then I will go into detail of how they work and how they interact with their surroundings. And then finally I will give you a few examples of what they can be used for. So first, how can you get those blocks? Well, you can't find them lying around usually, but you can craft them of course. And the crafting recipes you can see here. For the slime block it's 9 slime balls in a 3x3 grid. And for the honey block it's a 2x2 grid of 4 honey bottles. Here you will also get 4 empty glass bottles by the way. Those crafting recipes are reversible, meaning that you can craft a slime block back into 9 slime balls, and you can craft a honey block with 4 empty glass bottles back into 4 honey bottles. So those two are also ways to storage slime balls and honey in a rather compact way. Next, let's talk about the blocks themselves. So both the slime and the honey block can let light through, so they are somewhat transparent for light. They also allow mobs to spawn on top of them. They can be placed down like any other normal block without the need to be directional or to look where you want to place them from. And what's making them somewhat special is that you can instant mine them without any tools needed. The slime block furthermore is a full block, so it can transmit redstone power. The honey block is not a full block, it's a transparent block, which thus can transmit redstone power. And although the hitbox, when you're looking at it, looks like a 1 meter cube, the actual hitbox is actually a cube with a side length of 0.875 meters. Meaning that if you walk on top of that, you will actually fall down a tiny bit, as you can see here. And you can actually stand on a ledge made by this in a otherwise flat wall. Just a little nice to know there. Another result of that is that falling sand entities will actually drop as an item and not turn into a block when they land on honey blocks. A few more information about the honey block are here. So they also attract bees. And mobs avoid it, so they don't like standing on honey blocks. And that's the block itself. Now let's talk about the functionality. Let's start with the interaction with blocks. Here, the honey block and the slime block behave exactly the same. Basically, what a honey and the slime block can do is, when they are being moved, they try to grab two movable blocks around them and move them with them. If that movement is somewhat obstructed, the slime block itself or the honey block will not be moved. The only exception to that is that a slime block will not move a honey block if it's just sliding on the side, like here, and vice versa. So concerning each other, they are slick blocks. And as you can see, basically when the slime block is moved, it also tries to move this movable block, but it won't try to move immovable blocks. So the corresponding groups of blocks I already explained in the piston video or piston episode. And just a little reminder here, movable blocks, then we have the immovable blocks, then the sticky blocks, brittle blocks, and then the slick blocks, and so on and so on. And the same groups apply to honey and slime blocks. One important thing to know is that the stickiness only applies when the sticky block is actually being moved. If it is not being moved, they are not sticky. So as you can see, I can move this block around without influencing this block here. Now, if you want to move honey blocks with slime blocks or vice versa, you will need some kind of interlocking structure like here. And what you also can see here is that this movement can also be indirect. So this honey block has no direct connection to this slime block, sticky piston there, but is only moved through this slime construct. There can also be normal blocks in between. It doesn't matter. As soon as I'm moving this one here, it will move this block with it. If that movement of this block is obstructed, the entire chain is obstructed. As you can see, it can't extend. Ways to obstruct it are immovable blocks. Then if you try to move more than 12 blocks, the piston will not be able to do that. That's for pushing and pulling, of course. And you also can't push anything into the void. Following that, let's talk about some special cases and tricks to know about in the interaction between slime blocks and other blocks, for example. The first is what I call a one-tick staging trick. I'm using this quite often in my bigger doors. And that has to do with an effect I already tried to explain in the piston episode. And that effect is the following. When you are moving a block via piston, that movement takes one redstone tick. For another redstone tick, those blocks you have just moved count as immovable. That's rather important to know, and I'm not quite sure whether I was able to explain it properly in the piston episode, but anyway. Let's continue with this here first. So, what you can see here is we have a structure of some slime columns with blocks around them. And if you count, then you will see that this piston and this piston have to move 13 blocks, which is of course impossible. But this piston here has only to move 9 blocks, which is quite feasible. Now, using the fact that blocks I have just moved are counting as immovable and thus are not counted towards the push limit, I can actually make the entire thing here move if I stage the entire thing correctly. So as you can see, if I activate them with a one tick in between, one redstone tick in between, I can now move the entire thing. Because first I'm moving this thing here, those four blocks count for the next tick as immovable. During that time, I'm powering this piston, which then of course only has to move 9 blocks instead of 13, can extend, and here we have the same situation. A very useful thing to know and quite useful in certain circumstances. The next is somewhat based on this dynamic behavior when you are using one tick pulses into pistons, because as I tried to explain there, when a piston or a sticky piston is using one tick pulses and you have two working against each other, you can actually get around a bit around this one tick of waiting time. Meaning in this case here we have those two sticky pistons and they are going back and forth with a one tick delay in between and this quick clock. And what happens here is that this slime block, well, let's actually show you this in action. So you can see this line of slime blocks is actually sliding back and forth. You could do the same with honey blocks, of course. But what happens here is that this block here is being pushed and pulled back and forth faster than this one here can follow. These blocks here are not directly interacting with the sticky pistons, thus they have this one tick of waiting time. This block here doesn't. Meaning, these blocks here count as immovable, while I'm already moving this block once more. And that leads to this shuffling action going on there. Anyway, this trick was used quite early in the game, when slime blocks were just introduced, to build drawbridges of course, but obviously this can also be used to separate slime blocks from a slime block structure. Another way you can do the exact same thing is this setup here. So what you can see here is this column of slime blocks and quite a bit of redstone around it. And if I flick the lever here, we'll see now I have this slime block separated from those slime blocks here. Now what happens here? Basically, I'm using a trick using zero tick pulses. I'm giving this piston here a zero tick pulse, which immediately teleports this block over here. There is still some stickiness and those blocks also start to move over. But instead of being teleported, like this block here, those blocks here are actually moving as if they were moved by a one-tick pulse. Meaning, this line block is already in position and can be pushed back, while those here are still in motion and thus not sticking to this block. Basically, I'm pushing this over, those are too slow to follow, and I'm pushing this back in the original position before they can reconnect. That's what you can see going on here. And that's just some ghost blocks appearing. That's also sometimes possible. They are not really in the game. But that's also a way to separate slime blocks. And of course honey blocks. By the way, I've seen used this trick here only once by, I believe it was CubeHamster, who built a factory that assembled flying machines from their raw materials. But nevertheless, let's continue on with the interaction between slime and honey blocks with entities. And here, for most cases, slime blocks and honey blocks behave differently. So for blocks, they behave the same, but for entities, it's different. And the most basic way to say it is that slime blocks are bouncy and honey blocks are sticky. Anyway, let's start with the simple interaction with slime blocks and honey blocks in the floor. The first of all, if you are falling on top of a slime block, as you can see, you will start to bounce, but you will not get any falling damage. If you want to avoid this bouncing, you simply press the spacebar for jumping. Then you will only jump up one block instead of bouncing up the entire thing. What I wouldn't recommend is pressing shift to crouch, because then you will not bounce, but you will get the full falling damage. Rather important to know there. There's also an upper limit to the bouncing, so generally the higher you come, so the faster you are, the higher you will bounce up again. But the maximum is, according to the wiki once more, about 57.5 meters. Another thing to know about the slime block is that when you are walking on top of it, you will walk with only 30% of your maximum speed. And if you put a half step on that, you will walk with double that, so with about 60% of your maximum speed, or normal speed. The honey block is somewhat similar. Instead of bouncing, you will land on it, but you will only get about 20% of the falling damage. Also, instead of the bouncing, what happens on a honey block is that you can't jump as high. So as you can see, I can jump a bit higher than one block here, but if I am on the honey block, I can only jump 3/16 of a block. If I have jump boost 1, this is 3/4 of a block, and with jump boost 2, it's about 1/1/16 of a block. The speed reduction is also 60%, so you are only moving with about 60% of your normal speed. A step on top doesn't change anything, so with a step on top, it's the same for the slime and the honey block. Now I mentioned that you can only jump less than half a block, but you can still walk up half a block, so steps and stairs are still something you can go up from a honey block. Following that, let's talk about interaction with walls made out of those blocks. First, let's look at a slime block, and as you can see, nothing much happens, you simply fall down. Now let's do the same with a honey block, and as you can see, I get slowed down quite a bit. But this only works if you are actually right inside of the honey block, so if you are truly touching it, and not only if you are just to the side of it. Another thing to know about is if you, for example, throw items along a honey block wall, you can see that it travels quite a long distance horizontally and is only slowed down vertically. Also something nice to know about this. Next, let's talk about what happens if the honey and the slime blocks are being moved. First, with the slime block, as you can see, when the entity is on top of it, nothing happens. When the blocks are sliding below it, For the honey block, the entity is actually sticking to the honey block and being moved with it. This is only if the entity is on top. If the entity is on the side of it, for example pushed onto it with water, it will not be moved with the honey block. Next interaction is what happens if the blocks are pushed or pulled into or from the entity. Well, let's start with the slime block. When I push this slime block upwards into the entity here, you can see the entity is being launched upwards in this case. I can do the same sideways. And the distances you can travel here are about 6.5 meters upwards or 3.5 meters sideways. The honey block, as you can see, acts like any normal block here, and the entity doesn't really stick to it when it's being moved. And that's the entity interaction, and with that, let's get to the examples here. The most obvious use for slime and honey blocks is of course extending the reach of pistons. Here, for example, I have a simple signal line, which goes up and is using slime blocks to extend the distance between the sticky piston and, in this case, the redstone block. That can also go around corners, can branch off in many directions, as long as you stay below the 12 block pushing limit. The next thing you can do with that is actually moving blocks around. That can be a segment in a door, but it can also be a linear direction like here. So what you see here is a simple conveyor belt using two slime block columns. And as you can see, with the correct timing, using again the trick with the immovability of the block after it's being moved, you can get this forward movement going on. Rather useful little thing right there. Another thing you can do are certain types of multi-piston extenders. Here a design I came up with quite some time ago, which can be extended infinitely. Then one special use for the honey block is what I call a honey trap. So if you have honey blocks and all around you have a one high space, you can't get out of it, or the animals you put in there can't get out of it, or whatever. So quite a useful animal pen if you don't want to have fences over there, and you can actually get right to this edge here without any issue. Next, quite obvious, which I already shown you, is using slime blocks as a launching or as a landing platform, which makes it possible to fall big distances without getting any damage. The opposite is the launching platform, which can go up and sideways and allows you to move entities in all possible directions. That can work with mobs. You can also move drops that way, or XP balls, or even players, so there are many, many options there. Another use for those blocks are the rather common designs you can see here for block update detectors based on pistons. Quite obvious are doors, here a more modern version, but there are also slightly older versions using pistons and slime blocks. And of course I would also mention my big vault doors and similar things, which also use slime blocks in great amounts. A rather special use is this setup here, which allows you to trigger the TNT and duplicate it at the same time. So as you can see, we get a TNT, which would explode of course at some point if it wouldn't fall into the void here. But as you can see, the entire system resets properly and I'm left in the same position as before. This can also be implemented as part of a flying machine and thus used to bore a tunnel through somewhere, through a mountain or similar, for example. Ilmango makes use of this quite a lot. And the last thing I want to mention here are flying machines, so with slime blocks or honey blocks, which glue the entire thing together, and then sticky pistons, and for the modern versions, mostly observers, you can build quite easily two-way flying machines, or if you are using older designs, one-way flying machines. A name you will hear with that is often Slimestone, which refers to a combination of slime blocks with redstone blocks, which were the first flying machines. Uses for that are quite numerous. You can use them in farms, you can extend the slime blocks into rows to make mob swipers and mob farms, and many, many other things. So quite versatile. And that's the end of this episode about the slime and the honey blocks. I hope I was able to explain to you how they behave and how they are usually used in Minecraft redstone contraptions. I also hope you enjoyed this little episode, and well, see ya!